Production and distribution of City Club Forums on IdeaStream are made possible by the generous support of PNC and the Raskin Family Fund, with additional funding from Cleveland State University, Robert Conrad, and the Payne Fund.
Good afternoon, and welcome to the City Club of Cleveland. I'm Dan Malthrop, Chief Executive here at the club and also a proud member. It's my pleasure and honor to introduce today's forum, a conversation on the importance of philanthropy and service to the community as seen through the eyes of one of our nation's most important African-American Greek letter organizations, the Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority. AKA, as it is known, was the first Greek letter organization established by African-American college women, founded in 1908 on the campus of Howard University in Washington, D.C. And since then, membership has grown to more than 283,000 women who commit themselves to community service, scholarship, and sisterhood. Alpha Kappa Alpha members have gained recognition as artists, writers, engineers, and mathematicians, such as Katherine Johnson, Dorothy Vaughan, and Mary Jackson, the three women at the heart of the recently released movie, Hidden Figures. These three women, all AKA sisters, worked to propel John Glenn, Ohio's John Glenn, into space. Now, nowhere is this leadership more apparent than here in Cleveland, Ohio. The Alpha Omega chapter, the first graduate chapter of the AKA sorority, was established on the campus of Western Reserve University, which is now Case Western Reserve University, in 1917, making 2017 your centennial anniversary, ladies. Currently, Cleveland is home to thousands of AKA sisters who work to protest injustice and discrimination and promote equal opportunity for African Americans, and many of them have joined us today. It's so wonderful to have all of you here. Now, our program today is in a little different than our standard forum. First, we'll hear a short presentation from Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated's International President and Madam Supreme, Dorothy Buchanan Wilson. And then she will be joined here, and as she is already on stage, by KeyBank Foundation Chair and Chief Executive Officer, Margot James Copeland. And finally, we'll have our traditional City Club Q&A. So let's begin. Dorothy Buchanan Wilson is the 29th International President of AKA and the first woman from Wisconsin to hold the position. She's serving a four-year term through 2018. Ms. Buchanan Wilson guides policy, develops programs, and sets the leadership tone for this storied organization. Professionally, Ms. Buchanan Wilson's career has spanned the nonprofit and for-profit sectors, having worked for Xerox, SC Johnson Wax, and Goodwill Industries. Most recently, she was Senior Vice President of Mission Services at Goodwill Industries of Southeastern Wisconsin and Metropolitan Chicago. Ms. Buchanan Wilson holds an MBA from Clark Atlanta University and a bachelor's degree in Business Administration and Economics from Benedict College. Ladies and gentlemen, members and friends of the City Club of Cleveland, please join me in welcoming Madam Supreme Dorothy Buchanan Wilson.
Thank you so much.
Good afternoon, everyone. We're here this afternoon to talk about Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, but today happens to be the anniversary of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated. Let us give them a round of applause. So the officers and members of the City Club of Cleveland, and you just met the CEO, Mr. Dan Malthrop, to Miss Margot James Copeland, Chairman and CEO of the KeyBank Foundation, and to all others assembled, thank you for joining us this afternoon. It's indeed a pleasure to be here at the City Club of Cleveland, one of the oldest independent continuous free speech forums in the nation, where you are known for your tradition of diverse audiences, exploring major issues, and impacting communities. As International President of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, I'd like to share with you a brief overview of the organization, which is our nation's oldest service-oriented organization for college-trained African-American women. And so let us begin. The story of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, established in 1908 on the campus of Howard University in Washington, D.C., is a story of dedication, commitment, hard work, and community service. 16 collegiate women started this organization, one generation removed from slavery, that has grown to over 290,000 members in over 1,005 chapters worldwide. Our members make and take a lifelong commitment for service that extends beyond college campuses, as over 70,000 of us today work in communities providing service. And just to give you a sense of who's in this room, we have members in the organization who've been in the organization for 50 or more years. We call them golden members. If any of those members are present, would you please raise your hand or stand so we can see who you are? We have another group of women who are the heart of the core of our volunteer corps, and they are what we call our silver or our 25-year members. And if you're in the room, would you please stand so we could see you? And I point that out so that those who are not familiar with the history and legacy of organizations like Alpha Kappa Alpha and other sororities present, you get a sense that when we leave college, then our commitment turns into a lifelong of service. And so I'd like to begin today's presentation with our mission, talk about our membership, our history of service and outreach, move to our philanthropic efforts, and conclude with our local impact right here in Cleveland, Ohio, where one of our oldest and most esteemed chapters is located. Yes, in 1917. Alpha Omega chapter of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority came to Cleveland 9 years after Alpha Kappa Alpha was started. So this is one of our most esteemed chapters. Let's start with our mission. The sorority's mission was established 109 years ago and has remained largely unchanged. As we work to encourage high scholastic and ethical standards, we promote unity and friendship among college women, and we are of service to all mankind. And that piece, be of service to all mankind, is critical because that's been our primary focus as we've worked in over 1,000 communities to deliver critical service programs to those in need. Our members come from many diverse backgrounds. Over 1/3 of our members are educators. And that's not surprising given that we have a history of being a group started by educators. However, as you can see, we span all professions. And one of our more distinguishing features is that we have a core of seasoned community volunteers, with over 65% of our members being age 45 years or older. This active, stable volunteer base is considered to be one of our key strengths as an organization. Our members come from all walks of life. You heard about three of our more recent notable ones, but let's talk about a few others. We have, as members of Alpha Kappa Alpha, Mrs. Coretta Scott King, Eleanor Roosevelt, Mae Jemison, Maya Angelou, newly elected U.S. Senator from the state of California, Kamala Harris, and Miss Katherine Johnson, currently featured in the popular movie Hidden Figures, and they're all sorority members. And not only is Mrs. Katherine Johnson a sorority member, she is a 75-year member of this organization. She's still active in a chapter. For 109 years, Alpha Kappa Alpha has answered the call of critical service and outreach to those who needed our help. As noted, we have a strong history of service to others. So when you look at our track record for each decade that we've been in existence, you will see that our track record has been marked by distinguished service. Starting in the 1930s, our sorority organized the first mobile health care clinic in the Mississippi Delta. We then went on to basically launch a number of other major projects each decade, including securing right here in Cleveland, at that time, the largest federal contract ever awarded to a women's-based organization to operate a federal Job Corps Center called the Cleveland Job Corps Center, which at the time it was started was for women, but then it was later changed to a center for high school students. And we did that for over 30 years right here in Cleveland. So give yourselves a hand, Alpha Omega Chapter. Our volunteer members take the commitment of service to all mankind very seriously. Last year, for example, we served nationwide 1.5 million families. Our current international program is launching new dimensions of service, and we are focusing on five program target areas. Target one is educational enrichment. Our signature effort is a program for high school males and females called Ascend. It's a youth mentoring program where we are assisting 20,000 young people with job and career skills, getting them ready to go into their life after college, after high school, whether it's college or vocational. We're also collecting, as a part of our investment in middle school children, backpacks, 500,000 to be exact, as a part of our 1 million backpacks program. We started off very fast with that effort, and we're doing a lot of other programs. And because those backpacks are now turning into weekend meals for children and all kinds of other things, we've taken that number down to focus on the substance of the program more so than the count of backpacks. But as of right now, we are nearing a 500,000 backpacks in 2 years for middle school students. So Alpha Kappa Alpha members, give yourselves a round of applause. Another educational target focus is our Think HBCU initiative. Our nation's historically black colleges and universities are national treasures, and we are focusing on making sure that there is awareness of the need to continue support behind these historic institutions. Target two for the sorority is health promotion, and we are working with three major partners, the Alzheimer's Association, the American Heart and Stroke Association, and the National Alliance on Mental Illness to focus on Alzheimer's disease, heart disease, and mental health. And these are all areas which disproportionately impact families of color. Target three is family strengthening, and our members are focusing on addressing childhood hunger and providing seasonal or winter wraps. Target four is environmental ownership, and again, this is an area where we are having a lot of fun as we are working to refresh and restore 1,908 playgrounds for children nationwide, and we've already refreshed and restored 1,000 playgrounds as of today. Target five is global impact. We are implementing the UN Global Classrooms Program and working with AfriCare. How many of you in this room worked on the Little Dresses for Girls in Africa project? Probably everyone. Well, just for the audience members who are here, we set as a target for our international convention this past summer in Atlanta that we would bring 29,000 little dresses to the conference to send to girls in Africa. When we came to the conference, we had 57,000 little dresses for girls in Africa. So thank you, Alpha Kappa Alpha members. And we actually made each one by hand or sewing machine. Literally, they were made by the members. So we thank them for that. So as you can see, what we do is we set definite metrics because we know that when you're involved with community programs, especially with community partners, it's important to set metrics in terms of what will the outcome be and what results we expect to achieve. And so we have metrics set in terms of the impact that we want to continue to make over the next few years. We're currently on schedule to deliver the following metrics. We will mentor 20,000 Ascend students. We will provide 500,000 backpacks. We will raise $5 million for historically black colleges and universities, and we will increase awareness of stroke, mental health, and Alzheimer's disease. We will serve 1 million families, and we will build and beautify 1,908 playgrounds, as well as initiate major programs with the United Nations. In addition to our hands-on service, our members also provide financial support for those programs that you heard referenced. Last year, on the national level, we donated and provided at our annual biennial convention nearly $1 million in support of our community partners and service efforts. Further, our local AKA chapters, and you heard that there are 1,005 of them, contributed an additional $4.3 million in support towards those same programs. So as you can see, philanthropy is a very important part of what we do in the sorority, and it's very important to our overall efforts. In addition to what we're doing to support our local programs, we also established 37 years ago our Educational Advancement Foundation. And we established that to ensure continued support of our number one thrust, which is education. All active members of the sorority support EAF, is what we call it, with annual dues. The foundation has assets of $12.5 million currently and has granted nearly $5 million in scholarships and community assistance awards since its inception. Through our efforts and community partners, EAF awarded last year alone $500,000 to over 300 deserving students, and most of these students are not members of Alpha Kappa Alpha, and we also donated monies to community organizations. So again, Alpha Kappa Alpha members, give yourselves a round of applause. And what's significant and important to remember about EAF is that we started EAF in 1980 with a $10,000 seed grant from the sorority to start this foundation. So again, we invested in the organization. We expect to continue our strong level of philanthropy as we move forward. I'd like to provide you with an international perspective. I'm providing you with an international perspective on the sorority's programs and its philanthropy. And as mentioned earlier, we have over 1,000 chapters with members engaged in providing support to their respective communities. One of our oldest chapters is located right here in Cleveland, Ohio, and that's the chapter that we're celebrating this weekend with their centennial celebration, Alpha Omega. They have over 300 members. And if you're a member of Alpha Omega chapter, please stand at this time. I suspect that's most of the room. Thank you. Alpha Omega chapter is celebrating this entire year a century of service and impact. They are very active in this community. They are involved in any number of service projects, but let me just share with you some of their most recent results. They donated $20,000 in annual scholarships. They obtained funding for, and they currently manage, a 55-unit apartment building for low-income seniors. They sponsor numerous youth-focused programs, support all national service programs, and they are currently working on an organ and tissue education project. This chapter has also worked, as I mentioned earlier, for over 30 years to support one of our national projects, the Cleveland Job Corps Center. Their tremendous work is known throughout the organization. When you say in Alpha Kappa Alpha, Alpha Omega, everyone knows that's Cleveland, Ohio. They know that was the home of the Cleveland Job Corps Center. And they know that's the home of national officers, past national presidents, a number of regional directors, and current leaders of the organization. So they are noted for their service and for their contributions. And so we're here this weekend to celebrate them, to celebrate their 100 years of service to Greater Cleveland. Each year, we celebrate not only here the centennial of Alpha Omega Chapter, but we also celebrate the founding of our great organization. This coming Sunday, on January 15th, we will celebrate 109 years of continuous service to this nation. We are especially proud of this local chapter, and we're also proud of Alpha Kappa Alpha, because both of us have worked to create a strong legacy of service. Alpha Omega Chapter has worked here in the city to create a strong legacy tied around engaging the citizens of Cleveland in its program efforts, developing leaders both internally and externally, forging strong partnerships for over a century, and being a strong voice in this community. The work of chapters like this one, Alpha Omega, adds to the overall impact of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority as we continue our mission established 109 years ago by our founders. It has been a pleasure sharing with you the Alpha Kappa Alpha story very briefly, and also the Alpha Omega story, because that's the story that impacts what you do here in Cleveland. Again, thank you, City Club, for having me here as your speaker, as the kickoff speaker, I believe, for this season. I appreciate that very much, and I look forward to the continued conversation with Margot James Copeland. Thank you again, everyone.
First of all, let me just hold your hand because I am immensely proud of you personally. And I say this from my heart as my link sister. We're fellow national presidents. The good news for me is I'm done with mine. And you're still marching on.
Yes, I am.
But that's a club within itself.
It is.
And I was so privileged to serve my presidency in parallel to my dear friend, Carolyn House Stewart.
Yes.
We became very, very close because there is a circle of sister national and international presidents.
Sure.
And we do have, only we understand what
yes.
we go through,
exactly.
we talk to. So
exactly.
thank you and welcome.
Thank
welcome
you.
To the City Club. Welcome to Cleveland, Ohio. And we are so delighted to have you here. I want to go straight into the heart because what I want to do is leave time for the audience
sure.
to respond. So I want to go straight into the heart of really what I want to discuss. When you invoked the name of Katherine Johnson, it symbolizes to me, and we talked about this briefly backstage, it symbolizes to me, and I think the title of the movie, Hidden. Is so appropriate, because when you look at the traditions of not only African-American women's organization, but the African-American spirit in this country and contribution, which predates emancipation. You look at the contributions of Phyllis Wheatley and Mary Church Terrell and Ida B. Wells and on and on as we move forward, and Katherine Johnson, these significant individuals, women, we haven't even gotten to the men that do so much. The question I want to get to is, what is your view and perspective on why so much of our contribution as African-American people is hidden from the larger culture and society? And your example today and representation of Alpha Kappa Alpha is so important in making sure that the larger community, we know what we do, but the larger community understands our contributions.
Sure. It's interesting that you asked that question, because I actually had an opportunity this past spring to meet with Mrs. Katherine Johnson. And that very question came up. And I said to her, how does it feel to now have your story be told? And she said, I've been telling my story all my life. Others haven't been hearing it, or it just wasn't considered to be important. And I think a part of what we are now seeing, and what we as organizations like Alpha Kappa Alpha or Lynx and others have to do, is to make sure that those stories do get elevated. Because we know the stories, we hear them. You hear students now, you hear a lot of our friends saying, oh, I knew Mrs. Johnson. I had no idea she worked at NASA. I had no idea what she was doing. So a part of it is that we don't talk a lot about what we do or realize the significance of it. And so those of us who have the voice and have the means to do so, I believe we have an obligation to now make sure those stories certainly are told. A young African-American woman who's from Hampton, actually, knew of Mrs. Johnson and knew of the work of those pioneering women, went home, did some research, wrote the book, and then the book, again, got turned into the screenplay. So I think a part of what we have to do is to make sure that those stories aren't hidden any longer, because, again, this is a story that impacts everyone. You see families at the theaters of all colors, of all hues. You see a lot of young women who have been inspired by the focus on science, technology, and mathematics. And you hear them saying, it's okay to be smart, because that really is the message of the movie. It's okay to be smart no matter who you are. And so a part of what we have to do is to make sure those stories get told.
Great, thank you, it's a great answer. I think about a person who's very dear to me, our Link sister, my mentor, and your soror, Dr. Adrienne Lash-Jones, Professor Emeritus from Oberlin College, and the reason I sit in this seat for women like that who invested in me when I was a much younger woman. Adrienne wrote a book entitled The Colored Woman's Club Movement. She wrote it, and it was published back in the 80s, for those in the audience who would be so inclined to want to research that and know a little bit about us. And she researched the history and power and advancement of all of these organizations. Do you have a perspective collectively as we think about we are certainly greater together and the power we have together, any perspective that you have on how the African-American women's organizations have advanced American society?
I think when you look at the history of not only Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, but certainly other sororities and other women's groups, and many of us in this room are members of many other women's groups beyond our sororities, you will find that one of the things that has made us stronger, and I think one of our key strengths, has been the fact that women have always understood that it's important for us to stand together, and that together we certainly could move further ahead versus solo. And so a part of, I think, the attraction of our groups and the reason why we continue to stay active in those groups is because we can see where we're making an impact, where we're having an impact. We basically, all of our groups, we set every year our national objectives in terms of what we want to accomplish, and then we have annual meetings to make sure that we're checking on our progress. But I think the key thing is that we continue to work in communities where we can see the impact of our work. And so a part of our story is that we work as volunteers, we have a way of visibly seeing that we're making a difference, and then also we have an internal accountability built in. And I think the other thing is that we know, because these organizations, many of them are almost 100 years old or over 100 years old, that we're in this for the long haul. And that if it's going to be a change in our communities, it's going to start with us who are college educated. Many of us, when we come into these groups, when we join, we're told from the beginning, you are enjoying something that many of your mothers and grandmothers didn't get a chance to experience, the experience of having a college degree. You have an obligation to give back. We're told that in college. We're told that when we come into the organizations. And so we come in with that basically as our core belief. And so once we join, we know we're in this for the long haul, but we can't sit in here. We have to make a difference. And that's what we do.
Excellent. I'm just so proud. I don't know what to do. This weekend, we also celebrate the life of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. And one of his famous quotes, there were so many, but I do want to read it for the benefit of the audience and then turn the question to you. And it's his viewpoint on service. And he says, everybody can be great because anybody can serve. You don't have to have a college degree to serve. You don't have to make your subject or your verb agree to serve. You only need a heart full of grace and a soul generated by love. Dorothy, what is your perspective on service?
I think my perspective on service is very similar to that of every one of us here in this room. You know, many of us, when we don't have money to give to organizations or to give to our organizations, we provide service. And so for us, our organizations, in terms of what we contribute, the financial part and the volunteer part probably are equal in terms of what we do. And so in terms of service, you know, we take very seriously, as does I think most of our organizations, Dr. King's philosophy on we have an obligation to give back. Those of us who have been college educated, those of us who have the voice, who have the ability to speak out, speak up, advocate for, we have to be involved and to give back. And so in Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, as in many other groups, we take Monday very seriously. It is a day of service for us. We're not at work. We're out providing service in our community because we want to continue to make sure that we are showing to our children and our grandchildren that it's not just about service for service's sake, but that service that makes a difference in our communities. And so in addition to being about the business of providing service, on that day in honor of Dr. King, we also take off to make sure that it's not a day off, but it's a day of service.
Great, wonderful, great. I had the privilege this morning of seeing and hearing my soror, Dr. Janetta Cole, past president of Spelman College and Bennett College for Women, as well as the current, soon to be retiring, director of the Smithsonian African Art Museum. In her discussion with the audience, not only did she root down in service, but she talked about the example of service and dignity and respect that's been modeled at the White House for the last 8 years. Any thoughts on your part as we salute our 44th President of the United States as he steps down 1 week from now?
Well, we're very proud of President Barack Obama and his accomplishments, and certainly First Lady Mrs. Michelle Obama. Alpha Kappa Alpha members take particular pride because President Obama hails from Chicago, which is where our international headquarters is located. And we'll let you in a little secret. Our building, our corporate headquarters in Chicago, is directly across the street from where the new presidential library will be housed. So I said that to basically say that not only are we proud of his accomplishments and certainly all that they have embodied, because they were about stability. They showed about family values. They talked about the importance of education, about health, about making sure that there's a support system around you by taking the grandmother to Washington, D.C. And so these are all things that our organizations are about, you know, those support systems. And so we are very proud of them and their legacy. But more importantly, we are proud of what we know will continue to be happening in Chicago as a result of that library coming to Hyde Park, which if you know where Hyde Park is, that's an area that's not going to be very much developed, creating opportunities for people to work and to certainly be a part of that new phase of, you know, the president's legacy. So, you know, to sum up in terms of just the grace and dignity, I think she's been a role model for all of us, but certainly for those women in our sororities and women in our lives and those young women who will come certainly in the future.
absolutely. I'm going to have one last question. Dan says I can have one last question before we turn it over to you, because I could go on for an hour. I'm just pretending that you all aren't here. I'm having my own conversation, okay? When we invoke the word sorority and fraternity, and the Divine Nine, and we're not, and this is not a history lesson on the other eight, but you're the example today. But I think maybe, again, I believe in context and education. Right. And for the benefit or the edification of the larger audience that will hear you and see you, you know, listening audience as well as broadcast audience, would you give a perspective on sorority and fraternity life as is embodied there? Because I think there may be a stereotype that others may think of when they hear that and could be dismissive of that.
Sure. A couple of things, and we all hear this whenever we go to our conventions. You'll be in the elevator and someone will say, "You're still in a sorority or fraternity?" Okay. And then you say, and I'm sure they want to call me old, but that's not really what they say. But a part of what happens for us, for men and women of color, when we come into our sororities and fraternities, in effect, we're taking a lifetime service commitment. We're taking that vow to be active for life. And so once we graduate college, yes, we have fun in college, but once we graduate college, then we go into what we call graduate chapters, and we continue to be active in those chapters long after that college experience. For example, right now, Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority has 70,000 active members. 60,000 of those members are graduate people like ourselves on the stage. They've graduated college, they're professional women who, in their spare time, probably every spare moment, they're providing some level of service in their community. That's what they do, they're doing service. And so, and the other 10,000 are collegiate. Whereas I think for a lot of other groups, once they graduate college, they leave that whole experience behind. So when we come in, it's a different kind of experience for us. And the big part of what we do is that we generate millions of dollars for scholarships for young people wanting to go to college. We also provide service programs in communities, stabilizing programs. But a lot of what we do in our focus, no matter what the organization is, it's about education. We know the importance of building for the future because we've been there. We are college educated. And so our focus is just a little bit different, and our commitment is a little bit different, because when we come in, we're told from the very day you come in, this is about lifelong service. Not being a member for life, but serving for life.
It is a commitment for life. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Today at the City Club of Cleveland, we're enjoying a Friday forum with Dorothy Buchanan Wilson, Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated's international president, in conversation with great friend of the City Club, Margot James Copeland, chair and CEO of the KeyBank Foundation. We're about to begin the audience Q&A. We welcome questions from everyone, City Club members, guests, students from Shaw High School who are with us as well, or those of you joining us via our radio broadcast or our webcast or our live simulcast at the Parma Snow Branch of the Cuyahoga County Public Library. If you'd like to tweet a question, you can tweet it at the City Club, and our staff will work it into the program. And we do want to remind you that your questions ought to be brief and to the point. Holding our microphones today, our content coordinator, Teddy Eisenberg, and marketing and outreach coordinator, Faye Walker. May we have our first question, please? Somebody better jump up.
Yes, good afternoon. I would like to know what part you think our faith tradition plays in who we are and what we do as members of Alpha Kappa Alpha.
I think that our faith tradition plays a large part in what we do, because faith was very much one of the underpinnings when we were started as an organization. And so being a part of this group, you're very heavily involved with the church, you're told about commitment and about giving back and about helping others and about serving. And so those, again, are just core values and core tenets for who we are and what we do as members of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority. So that's our history. Faith is very much still a part of what we do today. And so I think that's reflective in our programs as well as just our overall efforts.
Thank you.
In the movie Hidden Figures, I was struck by how some of the things said to them are things that I've heard myself in the workplace. How would you both of you suggest that we work more to share those kinds of things so that the women coming after us are prepared to deal with those things and recognize it's not just history, but it's really current affairs?
Exactly. I think when you see Hidden Figures, if you're a working woman in any kind of environment, you basically, you saw situations that you found yourselves in every day. And I think there were key themes such as working together, that when one climbs, make sure others climb with you. Teamwork, that it's not easy, but you do what you do. And then when it's important to speak out, speak out. And so I think you're right. We do have an obligation to make sure that we mentor, as all of our groups do. We all have mentoring programs, that we mentor young people and young students and certainly our younger members. But I think we also have to make sure we tell our stories, you know, because many of us were sitting in the theater with tears running down our faces saying, we go through this and we haven't said anything to anyone about how do you deal with these situations, not only in the workplace, but just going through life. And so a part of what we have to do as members of this organization, the sorority, is to make sure that we tell those stories and make sure that we give advice to those coming behind us and make sure that we're not so hidden, which is what Margot and I were talking about earlier. You know, we should not be there in 2017, and that those things are more exposed for what they are.
And I would add to that, Cassandra, how you doing? I would add to that in the workplace, and of course I've got to do my KeyBank moment as relates to this. Although KeyBank is recognized in this community and beyond as a diversity leader, and certainly I feel very proud of that and we deserve that, it requires constant and critical conversations. It also requires a leader that is committed. And even if the leader basically says, I need you, Bruce, and you, Margot, or you and whoever to deliver that, knowing that we have that imprimatur to move forward on the kinds of things that we do inside of our organization, our own culture, to expose and bring in. And I'll just use one example. We host a MBA case competition every year in partnership with Ohio State, and we bring in over 100 MBA students from 30 universities across the United States. Great experience for them, but I make sure that my white corporate executives, my bankers, are there a part of this, because I want them to see that these students exist. And that's so important. They see them real time working. Okay, so that's just one example. So to give example, to make sure we kind of unearth what's hidden and make sure that, in other words, people will look at us and think we're unique and we're unusual when we know we're not.
Good afternoon. I'm very interested in hearing your perspectives in terms of what is our new social justice imperative, given what we know will be coming into the White House very soon.
Well, I think, well, you know, I think, you know, when you think about women and you think about people of color, I think we all right now have a wait and see attitude. We're waiting to see what's going to occur. But no matter what happens, I think in terms of social justice, all of our organizations, we've always been advocates for what's right. Mm-hmm. And when it's something that needs to be said about what's right, we have to take a stand. That hadn't changed. Mm-hmm. It's not going to be any different going forward as it has been in the past. Look at the women that you saw on that screen earlier from Alpha Kappa Alpha. You saw a lot of civil rights pioneers That's up right. there. Our work is still ongoing. Our work will still continue because guess what? The people that we're serving in our communities, they're still in our communities needing our help. So we're going to have to go to Washington to make sure that we lobby and advocate for programs that we need. We're going to have to get funding for a lot of what we're doing. And that means we have to coalesce with other groups. That means we have to go and talk to other people about what we need to have happen. But the reality is, when we were started in 1908, the country was what it was. Alpha Kappa Alpha women had work to do, and we did it. It's 2017. The country is what it is. We have work to do. And ladies, we have to do it. No matter who's in the White House, we have work to do. Yes. And we can't sit back and not do it. And we have to speak up and do and say what we need to do and say. And so be the voice. Yeah. Either voice.
I have nothing to add or embellish on that. I agree. I'll put an exclamation point behind that. I'll tell you a quick story. I had two college students from Cleveland State University who I mentor come to see me the other day. One's 19 and one's 20. This is a great opportunity, quite frankly, to bring our young people in close to what some of us lived or our parents lived, and more than what we read about, our parents actually lived the experience of the 50s and 60s. And I had a chance to explain to them all of the rights and privileges that they currently enjoy and take for granted. And the history, and I rolled it all the way back. I started with Obamacare, and I took it back to the executive order signed in 1972 by Nixon on affirmative action. And I said, and this is where you have to understand one begat another and another and another. And these are the things you have to pay attention to. And then I began to imagine with him. I said, imagine if you wanted to move to Medina and someone told you you couldn't buy a house. I said, imagine, and we went through, I think this is a wonderful opportunity for our young people, for them to understand and appreciate the sacrifices, the work, the efforts, and even those who died for the rights and benefits and entitlements they have today.
Yes.
Good afternoon. Since both of you are leaders within your prospective organizations, what do you want your legacy to be?
I think when you look at what we are working on now in Alpha Kappa Alpha, the legacy has to be that no matter how wonderful the organization, you must have a strong infrastructure and support around the organization, meaning that you must have the right staff, you must have the right buildings and facilities, you must have the right volunteers, and you must have the right spirit around the volunteers. If nothing else is said about what has happened over the last 2.5 years of Alpha Kappa Alpha, I think you see a refreshed and renewed spirit of sisterliness in the organization. You have your voice, you can say, you can speak freely about whatever you need to, and you're heard, and you're responded to. We hear you, and so a part of what I want my legacy to be is that we try to open it up so that you felt that the organization belonged to you. You joined it, you've been investing in it all your life, it is really yours. And so now I think we have that shared ownership again. And so that's what I want people to feel, that it now is something that I can say that a part of it belongs to me, and I have ownership, and I have to own it, and more importantly, have to carefully nurture it and make sure it's there for the next generation. So that's my thought on that one.
My link sister, since you're still in stride, and I was able to step down 3 years ago now from the stage, my dear Terry Eason gave me a crystal, a memento of my presidency. And it's a quote that I would say to my links membership often, and it was, make no small plans.
Yes.
The power and promise of our organizations is incredible. And there's no role for anything less than excellence.
Yes. Yes.
And so to take small ideas from ordinary people and make them extraordinary accomplishments for our people is really the power and promise of our organizations. And that's what I think and I hope my legacy would be in the Links Incorporated.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. President Buchanan Wilson, you mentioned that many of us are educators in the sorority. And so my question relates to education. Education tends to still be a problem affecting African-American youth disproportionately in a negative way. Everything from pre-K expulsions to disproportionate levels of graduation from high school and college. Can you comment on the state of education as it stands right now, what our role could and should be, and specifically talk about the role of HBCUs now in this century going forward and why there's still a need for them?
Right now, the focus of this, we work with middle school children under Carolyn House Stewart, and then a lot of those young ladies graduated to high school, and we're continuing to work with high school students now, and then we added young men to the mix. And so we're very much invested in children who are in the active education system, and certainly there are challenges. that we're facing, and a part of why we are focusing on Ascend and focusing on those high school students is we're quite honestly working on trying to make sure that they understand that there are options once they get out of school. Because a part of what we find is that somewhere between elementary and middle school, a lot of our kids tend to lose hope in terms of whether or not there's options for them when they get out that make sense. And so unless they can be shown a clear path to options in terms of here's what you can do, be, and where you can go, you know, they kind of lose focus and momentum, and you get the high dropout rates that you see here, that we see in cities like Milwaukee and Chicago. I mean, those dropout rates are, you know, approaching 50% in many cases. And so a part of our program is focused on those groups, and we're working, and so many of our members are in the trenches in those schools making a difference every day. But we certainly have a lot more work to do, and so we have to continue to work with educators and others to come up with creative options for educating our children, understanding that one size doesn't fit all. There are cultural nuances that we need to be concerned about. And so this is just an ongoing area for development and work, the way I see it, and we're doing it. The work is being done. It's just that, you know, you don't turn around things overnight, but certainly I think we are making progress, but there's still a long way to go, and those rates are what they are, and we gotta continue to try to get them down. In terms of HBCUs, we're focused specifically on the nation's historically black colleges and universities, because, you know, there are those who say that those schools aren't relevant and we don't need them. Well, we know that when you look at the mathematicians, a lot of the scientists, a lot of the medical doctors, and a lot of those people, engineers coming out of schools, those colleges are graduating a very high percentage of those professionals. And so there today is still very much a relevance for those institutions, but more importantly, they are institutions that many of us in this room came from. And a lot of our checks every week go to still to support children and grandchildren. And so clearly there is a need for those because, again, they create those culture, those nurturing environments that are more small in nature for our children to learn, where they're told they're special, where they can get that attention, where they're told you can achieve, and where for at least a short period of time they can work in an environment where they don't really have to feel they have to look over their or watch their back every 5 minutes. And so there still is a big need for them. That's why we're focusing on them. We want to make sure that we continue to look at them as a portal for those young people in high school to go to be educated.
Hi. My name's Shanaisha. Do you think that we'll get another African American president after this one?
I think absolutely anything is possible. You know, this is America after all. Certainly it's possible. You know, I'm a lot older than you are, so maybe not in my lifetime, but certainly. I think in your lifetime, you know, given the given the diversity of this nation. Look at the diversity, look at the demographics and where the trends are. Certainly, I think it's possible in your lifetime. You know, you're sitting there 15, 16 years of age.
And I would just add to that, I would certainly hope that we will see a woman president as well. But to me, quite frankly, and I'm sure my friend here, Dorothy, would agree, it matters less what color or gender the president is. We just want a president that is a good person and will represent all of us equally and uniformly. Mm-hmm.
Good afternoon. With Cleveland being on the map, we're the city of champions, what are Cavaliers, winning a championship. And you also mentioned as being a leader, you have to have a strong infrastructure and support within your organization. How important is it to different communities that we hold different conferences within the city? Because I know here in Cleveland, we have our upcoming regional conference hosted by our Great Lakes Regional Director, Tony Kendrick. What type of impact do you believe that will have effect on our city here, Cleveland, Ohio?
Well, I'm hoping it has the same impact here as we had in Atlanta with $60 million that was spent in the city of Atlanta this past summer by members of Alpha Kappa Alpha. But it wasn't just $60 million with hospitality. We spent, I believe it was somewhere between $6 and $7 million on programs and services that we left in that city. We built playgrounds from the ground up. We actually provided hundreds of thousands of meals, and we had programs that were being put into place like in April leading up to July. And then their program, we totally refurbished a neighborhood park, and it's been renamed after one of our past international presidents. And we went in there and actually put the equipment and everything in there and had them totally redo the park. And we made a lifelong investment to make sure that park is kept up. And so a part of what we want to do, we always try to do when we go to cities, and all of the women's organizations are committed to this, is that when we go, we try to do things in the city that will benefit the citizens of that city and the residents. And so a part of our hope for this conference is that we will have that same impact, that we don't spend it all in the hotels and downtown, as wonderful as it might be, but that we actually, to the people in need in our communities, we actually go out and spend some dollars there and leave dollars there for sustainable programs after we leave, because that's when you see the impact. And you have to be thoughtful about it and deliberate about it.
And from the business community in Cleveland's perspective, that is of high priority. I do know that my friend, Mr. Gilbert, over at the representing our Convention and Visitors Bureau, is aggressively going after conventions from African American organizations, especially national as well as regional meetings. The Sigma Gamma Rho sorority, one of our Divine Nine Sisters sororities, had their national convention here last summer, and he got a taste of the potential of bringing in other organizations as well. So that is a high priority of our business community at this juncture.
Good afternoon. We've truly enjoyed your presence here in Cleveland. Thank you. Excuse me. My question has to do with the national partnerships of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority. How are the national partners selected, and why is it important to have national partnerships?
The national partners are selected based on what are some of the current issues that are impacting the constituencies that we serve. Before I came into office, we did a survey and asked the members kind of what are some of the big issues. And heart disease came back, stroke, Alzheimer's, and mental illness was a huge, huge issue that the members wanted us to address. And they said, if nothing else, let's pull the stigma. Let's make sure that people of color understand it's not a stigma to be dealing with a mental health issue. And so that's why we quite honestly have the partnerships that we have right now. And a part of how we support them, as you know, is that each local chapter ties and aligns with those partners and their local affiliates. And then even nationally, we make major financial commitments to support their ongoing work and research. And so that's how the partners, for the most part, are selected. We tend to look at what's happening in the country at that time, what's happening in communities, and where the needs seem to be. And then based on what the members tell us, that those are the partnerships that are selected.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Angela Butler, and this is a two-part question for Margot. In terms of trends in corporate philanthropy, if you could share any insight on where you see that going, and for Madam Supreme, kind of the future direction in your vision for service, international service, as we look at, you know, how the world is changing, how the economy is changing. We've got the social media now. There's people are raising money online. So how does all of that kind of factor into where we're going? Because I know we don't do service the same way we did 100 years ago. So
trends in corporate philanthropy, really, as I meet with my colleagues around the country, the real focus is, you know, you can write a check and hand over a check, but how do you know it's met for its intended purpose? So looking for transformational change. So understanding on the front end, what do we want to accomplish? Who's the right partner to invest in? We are a bank, so we invest in that partner. And what we'd like to say is come to KeyBank Foundation with a blank sheet of paper. And let's talk about how we build a relationship and build and grow that. And then once we agree as to what we're going to fund, then we're going to measure the performance of that grant. And did you live up to nonprofit organization what you said that you would do? So there's a bit more rigor. I think it's gone from charity work to philanthropic work, and philanthropy to
transforming change, because in any given city, not just Cleveland, there are a myriad of problems and issues that are consistent across. We're in 18 states and almost 30 communities. I could close my eyes and be anywhere and hear the same problems and struggles that exist in Cleveland as I hear in Albany or Seattle or New Haven. So when we do that, we really want to make sure that the partners we're investing in can deliver on that promise, and then we will hold them accountable. We enter to an MOU, hold them accountable to deliver on what they've said. So when my sister Dorothy talked about the metrics that she has designed for your organization, that is very critical, because that's the kind of thing when you walk in the door with that to the KeyBank Foundation, our antenna's up, we like that, and that's where our conversations begin.
In terms of where Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority is going with this philanthropic efforts, as you know, we are continuing to invest in and build, this is our EAF foundation, this is our book, we're continuing to invest in the Educational Advancement Foundation. And so I think what you're gonna see over the next few years is that foundation now gets critical mass. You know, we're at $12.5 million. So we're now becoming a major player in some of the circles that we're in. I think you're gonna see continued investment by chapters as well as additional members in what's happening with the work of EAF.
Today at the City Club of Cleveland, we've been enjoying a Friday forum featuring Dorothy Buchanan Wilson, AKA's International President, in conversation with Margot James Copeland of KeyBank Foundation. Today's forum is part of the Diversity Thought Leadership Series, sponsored by a generous gift from KeyBank Foundation. We thank you very much for your support. And that brings us to the end of our forum. Thank you very much, Dorothy. Thank you very much, Margot. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Have a wonderful weekend and a good day of service. Thank you.
For information on upcoming speakers or for podcasts of the City Club, go to cityclub.org.
Production and distribution of City Club forums on IdeaStream are made possible by the generous support of PNC and the Raskin Family Fund, with additional funding from Cleveland State University, Robert Conrad, and the Payne Fund.